Thanks so much, everyone, for watching. We've got an epic lineup tonight of speakers.
We've got an awesome panel here.
Amazing group of functional doctors, technology, activists, for here for a leap forward in medicine.
This is a great gathering.
You know, our goal is to make it easy for practitioners to learn in community.
There's a lot of community happening tonight. I want to say welcome to all of the communities that are watching at home.
This ecosystem that has been set up by the meetup groups, we believe will be the future ecosystem of this evolved primary care network that we are looking to develop. And it all revolves around you.
There's an exponential potential to the future of medicine. This is an allopathic conversion machine that we have just created. And it has exponential potential because it can be seen by a billion people at no extra cost. That's the beauty of the internet.
Welcome to the Functional Forum. Thanks for joining us in the charge to accelerate the evolution of medicine. Please welcome your host, James Maskell.
Hello and welcome to the Functional Forum. On this month episode, we have come to the Environmental Health Symposium in sunny San Diego, California, to learn more about a rapidly evolving area of medicine, environmental medicine. We are going to hear from doctors who have been teaching professionals for decades. We're going to hear about some of the new innovations in delivery, and we're going to challenge you at home to really see how you can create detoxification structures for the whole population to be able to enjoy this kind of care. It's going to be a great hour. Enjoy.
So, Dr. Patrick, can you tell us a little bit about the history of environmental medicine movement in America?
Well, if you look back in the history of the United States, medically in the 40s and 50s, allergists were really starting to acknowledge that people were reacting to their environment, both the foods that they eat and the exposures that they have in terms of chemical exposures or toxicant exposures. And so those allergists actually started the first Environmental Medicine Association, which became the American Academy of Environmental Medicine. Along the way, they gathered primary care providers who were noticing that people were reacting to their environment and getting very, very sick. So this included not only pesticide exposures, but exposures to household cleaning products and, you know, exposures to foods that contained high amounts of heavy metals like mercury. So in the last, I would say, 30 years, how that has evolved is our total body loads have increased significantly. The number of clinicians who've recognized that environmental medicine is necessary in any primary care practice have grown. And so we have this whole new subspecialty in medicine called environmental medicine, which is kind of a fledgling specialty area. The docs in the AAEM, the American Academy of Environmental Medicine, are limited mostly by their culture, you know, their older doctors. There are newer doctors that are getting trained in functional medicine with a smattering of environmental medicine training in that. And then in my profession, the naturopathic profession, because of the nature of our understanding of treating the cause of disease, we gravitate towards environmental medicine. And now at this conference, what we're really starting to realize is the enormity of the problem. You know, we have an epidemic of Alzheimer's and Parkinson's and adult onset early dementias in this country that in large part are caused by neuroinflammation resulting from toxicant exposure. So what we're attempting to teach these physicians is, who is it? How do you recognize it? You know, everybody has a toxic body burden. The Center for Disease Control has identified over 100 toxicants that are ubiquitous. In other words, we can measure them in everyone. Everyone, whether they are a newborn or whether they are elderly. And so to take those toxicant exposures and really figure out in whom are they causative for chronic disease. How do you identify that? How do you measure them? And how do you look at the intersection between signs and symptoms and exposures? So it's a big job. But we feel like it's a necessary job in order for us to be able to move forward and stem this rising tide of chronic degenerative disease. You know, there's a tsunami, as you know, James, in both insulin insensitivity, prediabetes, diabetes, neurodegenerative diseases, autoimmune disease, cancer. I could go on and on.
Absolutely. So what, for a doctor that comes to one of these conferences, or this conference particularly, what at the end of the conference, what will they be able to do?
Several things. One is, what are the red flags? We recognize red flags in patients' presentation that signal toxicant exposure. So the signs and symptoms, what particular laboratory testing is going to elicit that, and what physical exam testing is going to elicit that. Second, how do you do a good intake on a patient to determine whether or not they have toxicant exposure? This is an art and a practice, and it's learnable. And so we actually teach intake. So intake would maybe necessitate a little bit more time with the patient. I had the great good fortune of working in a multidisciplinary clinic with several physicians, et cetera, where my job was to look for environmental exposures and actually elicit that information. So I would do a lot of Q&A with the patients, you know, and the intake form, which is, there's a specialty intake form for environmental medicine, isn't always complete. For instance, if I asked you if you ate fish, and you said, no, I don't really eat that much fish, then I'd have to figure out whether you think tuna fish is a fish or not. Because many patients don't even think that their tuna fish salad qualifies as a fish when it's the highest dietary source of mercury in most of the people in the United States because of the frequency with which it's eaten. So another area is really figuring out not only what clinical laboratory tests to do, but how to interpret them. And this is crucial because the laboratories, by law, have to use certain reference ranges in their interpretation of the data based on their own populations, based on their own data. They do not necessarily reflect risk level and don't necessarily reflect a diagnosis. So we then have to go into the epidemiological literature and the Center for Disease Control databases and elicit those reference ranges and teach them. And this is because this is a new science. The Center for Disease Control, NIEHS, is working very hard on this. The ATSDR, the Agency for Toxic Substances and Disease Registry, is working very hard to really try and figure out who are the risk populations for toxicant exposure. But there's no textbook yet on this.
Hi, I'm Dr. Anne-Marie Fine, and here's my tip for the functional medicine community. When you're doing a patient intake, don't forget to ask about environmental exposures. And you want to be clever about it. You don't just want to say, do you have any environmental exposures? Because nobody believes that they've been environmentally exposed to anything. And so you want to ask about, do they eat organic? Do they store their food in plastic? Do they heat their food in plastic? What kinds of personal care products do they use? Have they remodeled their home recently? Do they live in a new home? Have they just recently purchased a new car? That new car smell is the smell of toxins off-gassing into your car. And so when you're thinking of your intake, if you get a really good environmental idea of what's going on in their life, you don't have to do as many labs even, because you will have an idea of the toxin exposure, and total body burden is correlated to health. And just by depurating someone and bringing down that total body level, you will make incredible gains.
Hi, my name is Rodney Palmer. I'm the president of Saunaray, and I design infrared saunas. My 1 minute tip to practitioners is make your patients sweat. New science has shown that sweat contains 10 times more toxic metal than urine. So you can sweat out 10 times more cadmium, aluminum, lead, mercury. All these toxic metals were studied, 16 metals actually, and 9 of them were shown to be 10 times more present in sweat. You can also sweat out phthalate, bisphenol A. These are plasticizers that are causing unknown, an uncounted number of ailments among your patients. They are estrogenic mimics. They are carcinogens. And there's no other way to excrete them except by sweat. In many studies, they were shown to be present in sweat and non-detect in urine. So maybe it's the only way you can get it out. And the great thing about an infrared sauna as a new tool for doctors is that it doesn't necessarily have to raise the core temperature in order to make you sweat, instead of breathing superheated air like traditional saunas have always done in order to cause a bodily reaction to create sweat, the infrared heat gently penetrates the skin, excites the sweat glands, and excretes sweat. And these toxins are excreted in the sweat. So that's pretty much the number one thing I think you can do for your patients is make them sweat in an infrared sauna.
Having a great time here at the Environmental Health Symposium. I'm at the booths and I'm currently hanging out in the infrared sauna. If we're talking about neuroinflammation, it's going to affect mental health. And so we caught up with Dr. Kyla Kass, a psychiatrist, to talk about why the mental health profession and particularly psychiatrists should be interested in environmental medicine. Check it out.
I think environmental medicine is an essential part of psychiatry. And even though it's not part of conventional training, sadly, it's so important because so many symptoms of environmental illness show up psychiatrically. And years and years and years ago, I've been in this for maybe 25 years, I was looking at environmental issues because I knew we had the field of clinical ecology, which has morphed. And when we have patients that present with anxiety, depression, brain fog, and a myriad of physical symptoms, but often psychiatric presentation, rather than doing the conventional thing, which is whipping out the prescription pad for an SSRI, for antidepressant, what a doctor who looks at environmental medicine, like myself, does is check people for heavy metals, environmental toxins, mold, based on their history. And sometimes the history won't even reveal it. But I can't even tell you how many patients come to me with what are standard psychiatric symptoms, and what they really have is heavy metal toxicity, mold toxicity, or chemical poisoning.
What are some of the signs in some of your patients that you have a patient in front of you with environmental illness?
It can present in any way, because what happens is you get brain inflammation. All of these affect the brain mitochondria, the mitochondria of the neurons, of the brain cells, and cause inflammation. And so you have mitochondria that aren't working, which means the energy system of the cells aren't working. You have an inflammatory condition. And when your brain's inflamed, it just isn't working properly. So all the things that we rely on our brain for, which is good mood, good energy, being able to think clearly, make good decisions, have a good memory, all those disappear, or they're impaired in some way. And again, in standard conventional psychiatry, these are treated with medication, or the patient is told it's all in their head. Well, it's not, it's in their whole system. And it is chemical, and it is remediable when you know how to test for it and how to treat it.
So what is the standard training for physicians in environmental medicine?
The standard training for a physician in environmental medicine really doesn't exist. I mean, I certainly didn't learn any in medical school, internship, residency training, not at all. In fact, at one point I was doing workers' comp evaluations a very long time ago. And people who were obviously chemically exposed, they were working with chemicals. These are workers who were doing cleaning or some sort of processes, actually often without gloves and protective gear, and were being told it was all in their head. And I was the psychiatrist who was supposed to defend their mental state. Instead, it was clearly an environmental toxin issue, and that wasn't admissible under workers' comp. So it was a really big issue at the time. Hopefully now there's more recognition of this, but not as much as there ought to be. I mean, this absolutely should be part of psychiatric residency training.
Hi, I'm Dr. Kabran Chapik. I'm a naturopathic physician. With primary experience in psychiatry, we recently founded the Psychiatric Association of Naturopathic Physicians, a specialty group to help train doctors, naturopathic doctors, in ways to help their patients with different mental health illnesses. Now, at this conference, I'm talking about neurodegenerative diseases, in particular Alzheimer's disease. Now, based on the work of Dr. Dale Bredesen, he's shown that Alzheimer's disease is not one thing. The cause is not one thing. And especially at this conference, we're learning that toxins are a significant cause of neurodegenerative illness. And so I strongly encourage you to screen your patients for symptoms of memory problems. The SAGE is a simple pencil paper test that can be done in 10 or 15 minutes. It doesn't take clinician time, S-A-G-E, and your patient can do that, and you can pick up on some of these memory problems, and then you can work them up by doing labs, by doing imaging, such as a volumetric MRI. So volumetric MRI is a way to look at temporal lobes, brain volumes, compared to age-matched controls. And, you know, MRIs are on every street corner now, pretty much. So easy to do, easy to order, and a good way to really objectify changes in your patient's brain when they may be having neurodegenerative problems.
So let's say that you have a patient that comes in the office and you suspect that they have an environmental illness. How do you know what the exact environmental toxin is? We asked Dr. Aviad Elgez to talk us through the differential diagnosis for the top five most common environmental illnesses. Enjoy.
I've been in practice for the last 9 years or so, and in the last 5 years I've focused a lot on environmental medicine. And in these last 5 years, one of the focus that I've had is neurotoxicity. It's something we see very commonly in practice. So I've sort of narrowed down the primary, most common neurotoxic exposures that we have into a sort of differential diagnosis picture to help other practitioners figure out what are they seeing in practice. So the most common two types of neurotoxins that we see are going to be solvents and mold, beyond a doubt. So I'll give you the highlights of what are the main key to look at. There's a lot of different symptoms, a lot of neurotoxicity, immunotoxicity, endocrine disruption, mitochondrial disruption. But just for today, here are the key differentiation factors for neurotoxicity for these. So solvents, what we're looking at really is that balance issue. So people who are breathing in fumes, imagine, the off-gassing, the VOCs, bringing in paint. It gets sort of a little bit of spaciness, a lot of brain fog and a lot of balance issues, as well as some neuropathy. You'll see people with like burning pain sometimes and numbness and tingling. So that's one of the key features. Now, if somebody goes away on vacation, a lot of these symptoms can go away if they go for a long enough of a time, and considering they're not exposed to other solvents, like memory foam sometimes, a brand new memory foam in the hotel can actually continue the exposure if they're sensitive to that. What happens is solvents are not persistent in our body. It clears it pretty fast. So a lot of these non-persistent pollutants, after a few days, a few weeks of that exposure is gone, the symptoms will go away, they'll come back home, and the symptoms will come back with the exposures. The other thing to look at here then is mold. Mold is very similar in solvents in the sense that, you go away from the exposure, you'll see these ups and downs of symptoms coming and going. With regards to the symptoms though, even though you have a lot of similar symptoms like that brain fog as you do in solvents, and you might get that fatigue. Actually, across the board, almost all of these have fatigue, so I won't mention that too many times, but fatigue is there. You'll have this fatigue, you'll have this sometimes neuropathy as well for a mold. The other thing that you'll see specifically with mold that you don't see as much with solvents is you'll get a lot of that congestion. You get the sort of sinusitis, chronic congestion. The other thing that is very prevalent in mold is that recurrent infections, respiratory tract infections. You'll see that with solvents as well, but a lot more with mold at the same time. So that's one of the biggest concerns, is sort of a pattern that we see of neurotoxicity with immunotoxicity and the congestion picture of mold. Mercury is the other common picture that we see a lot, and a lot of people in practice are looking for it. It's not as common as people think, but when we do find it, it's pretty clear, and the symptoms are there. As sort of the key symptom that I like to look at is irritability and anxiety. You do get that fatigue, you do get that brain fog for mercury, but you get this irritable kind of picture, especially somebody who wasn't irritable at a certain point in their life and they're gradually getting worse. That is where you're going to see that that picture of mercury. You'll also get muscle pains as well, muscle aches. And one of the key things with mercury is that it's persistent. So you don't have that concern where you know, it comes and goes, comes and goes. It's always there. You go on vacation, that anxiety, the muscle pain, that fatigue is still there. You come back home, there's nothing changed. The other common exposure for neurotoxins that we have in our practice often is organophosphate pesticides. And these are the most common pesticides that that are sprayed on our food, on our produce right now. The neurotoxic picture of these organic phosphate pesticides are more of that sort of chronic exposure. The acute exposure that we have, we see in farmers, we see in there when there are spills, people who live next to farms will get that a little bit, but it's really going to be that prenatal exposure and that early development. Things like autism, ADHD, learning disabilities, that's very common and very much connected in the research for organic phosphate pesticides. But you also have it in adults over the long term, so that chronic neurodegeneration showing up in things like depression over the long term, and also Parkinson's or extrapyramidal symptoms like tremors and so on. So you'll see that with organic phosphate in the long run. Now, the last two here I'll combine together because they're very similar. That's PCBs and chlorinated pesticides. So those ones, they don't have a lot of neurological symptoms as a whole. There's a lot of cancers and a lot of endocrine disruption going on there. But from a neurotoxic perspective, both of these are linked with more of the chronic degeneration conditions like Parkinson's specifically is very well linked with both of these, as well as just dementias in general. So I think we're going to see more and more of these sort of chronic neurodegeneration over the years, lifelong exposures, especially from farmers, that's very much linked. You know, we're exposed to these as well. If we have genetic SNPs where we can't handle these or poor detoxification pathways, you'll see this in the common, everyday person in your practice.
So, Dr. Carnahan, what are some of the most effective tools that you recommend to patients once you understand that they do have an environmental illness?
So it depends a little bit what burden they have, because there's different ways to detoxify. I'm a big fan of binders, clay and charcoal, and sometimes glycomannans can work, and there's prescription binders as well. Treating the gut is huge because a lot of the source of toxicity is the bugs in the gut, and they can actually produce toxic metabolites as well and burden the patient, and that's easy. All of us functional medicine doctors know how to treat the gut. And then other therapies, like I mentioned, sauna and hydrotherapy, Epsom salt baths, mineral water, very simple things that can enhance their lymphatics, their kidneys, and their liver and detox.
So, Dr. Carnahan, you become an expert in mold, and there's discussion about mold this weekend. What do most physicians not know about mold that they need to know to help patients more effectively?
So the other elephant in the room is mold toxicity and patients' exposures to mold. And as I've become more aware of it through some of my own experiences, I see it all the time. There's so many workplaces and homes that have water damage, and even areas like Boulder, Colorado, where it's very dry, when there's been floods, there can be massive water damage and many people affected. And this affects, you see brain function, you see early onset dementia, which is really scary, but it's reversible. And you see attention issues, word finding, memory, recall, focus, concentration, all the cognitive areas. You see immune issues, so massive immune deficiencies, frequent infections, all of those types of things. And then also respiratory issues are very common. So I think there's this a whole subset of our population that's the trigger. And they're presenting with autoimmune disease or with asthma, and it's really a mold issue. I am so excited to be here at the Environmental Health Symposium 2017 with one of my heroes, Walter Krinyon. Years and years ago, when I was first learning about functional medicine and detoxification, I sat in on one of his weekend conferences, and I'll tell you what, it was life-changing. He taught me about heavy metals and detoxification protocols and how to test all the other chemicals that we have in our environment, and I have nothing but accolades to Walter and am delighted to introduce him today.
So what are the things that are known to cause neuroinflammation in a chronic setting? Well, one is traumatic brain injury. So, you know, there's a lot of TBI out there now. We've got all the vets that have it, all the pro football players that have it, all the young football players that have it, right? And motor vehicle accidents. You know, if you have supported clients who've had TBI from a motor vehicle accident, you know that it's not something that they get over quickly. right? You've got inflammation in the brain. There's only a couple little arteries going up there. You don't have a lot of anti-inflammatory, antioxidant activity up there. So once in this enclosed area they get the inflammation going on, it's not that easy to turn it around. So TBI is a big factor here causing it. Well, it turns out that endotoxins tweak it really well. What are endotoxins? Those are the bacterial cell walls, gram-negative bacterial cell walls from the intestines. What triggers the endotoxicity? Standard American diet, high-fat diet does that. And I'm going to review this later in the conference here, showing you how the microbiome will either stimulate neuroinflammation or will quench it. And that's all really based on diet. So neuroinflammation caused by lipopolysaccharides, endotoxicity. So you've got, you know, that good old gut-brain connection. Microbes will do it. So infective agents will do it as well. Glycation end products do it. So elevated blood sugar, which is with type 2 diabetes now being so prevalent, and yesterday in the lecture I covered a lot about type 2 diabetes being a direct result of our environmental burden. Matter of fact, I now consider the presence of type 2 diabetes to be basically pathognomonic for environmental overload. But any elevation of blood sugar does that. Stress does it, including trauma, PTSD, causes neuroinflammation, and then a whole host of ubiquitous environmental toxins. So including a whole lot of air pollutants, as we're going to find out. So it's like hold your breath. So you've got two different ways of really tweaking the primary and secondary pathways for tweaking the microglia. And in an acute situation, it's able to get balanced by anti-inflammatory cytokines. But when you get the TNF-alpha, gamma interferon, interleukin-6, interleukin-10, if you can't quench that, it becomes a chronic issue. So here's basically the acute versus the chronic. Is that in the acute, it's you're able to quell it with anti-inflammatory cytokines, interleukin-4, interleukin-10, and alpha interferon. And you have enough glutathione left in your brain to do the antioxidant action. So in your brain, if there's oxidative damage, and this is true anywhere in your body, inflammation is the next step after oxidative damage. You get oxidative damage, you get inflammation. What happens in the arteries from the oxidized LDL? The oxidized LDL hits it, oxidation, next step, inflammation. This is what happens throughout the body. Very, very, this is just, it's the two-step. Forward step. It's the two-step that goes on. So in the brain, you've got a certain amount of glutathione there to protect the mitochondria and all the neurons, etc. When that gets depleted, you can't fight off neuroinflammation. And so then you're going to have, in the chronic, the inflammatory cytokines prevail, glutathione depletion, and then you get in the Th17, which is the pro-inflammatory cytokine picture. Starts with interleukin 6 and 10, stimulates interleukin 17. You get in this whole astoundingly powerful avalanche of inflammatory cytokines that can't be stopped. Then you get the blood-brain barrier damage. So when you get Th17 going on here, you get inflammation. This is also present. It's very powerful in autoimmunity. So if you got someone with autoimmune conditions going on, you got a Th17 dominance. Do you think you're going to have neuroinflammation? Yeah, more likely than not. It's just going to be there with anybody that's got RA, lupus, MS. Well, MS is one of the neuroinflammatory processes. asthma, systemic sclerosis, all these things. And if you've got bowel inflammation, you're going to have neuroinflammation. It's just going to be there. It's just going to be there. And these are areas that, I mean, I've never heard neuroinflammatory protocols for any of this stuff, right? I haven't. So what are the toxicants that are known to incite a Th17 condition? Well, air pollution, particulate matter, and diesel exhaust. Very, very common. This is one of the reasons I'll get into it, why women living close to a roadway with diesel exhaust have higher rates of having autistic kids from the neuroinflammation. It's why kids who still live in that same house get their autism gets worse, the neuroinflammation. Cigarette smoke, mercury, powerful neuroinflammatory agent. BPA that we were just talking about. Now, there's no evidence to say that the other non-A bisphenols don't do this. My guess is it's the bisphenol part, not the A part, that really tweaks this. So the other bisphenols, trichloroethylene. Well, that's dry cleaning fluid, yeah, but it's a major groundwater contaminant in the United States of America. It's so important that on the EPA website, they've got a whole United States map so you can check the TCE contamination in your area. You should know this. Now, Dr. Patrick, you lived in Tucson a while, one of the great TCE hotspots for groundwater. Scottsdale, another TCE Superfund cleanup site, Scottsdale, Arizona, in the water there. This is common. It is very common. Polychlorinated biphenyls, so there you go, farm salmon, which you will not be served here at this conference. You will, in fact, be served Vital Choice Alaskan salmon, red salmon, at this conference. Thank you, Vital Choices. And then paraquat. Unless you're using paraquat, forget about it. But all the rest are like the first two. Air pollution, guess what you're breathing now? Particulate matter and diesel exhaust. You're in an urban area. I know there's a little water over here, but you know, there's traffic around here. So you're breathing this right now. So when you get this inflammation on this slide, I want you to focus on the area down here, these guys, putting out the interleukins and gamma interferon, causing the opening in the blood-brain barrier right in here. So this is the neuroinflammation. Again, it's done with the cytokines. It's all cytokine play in our body with inflammation and anything from the immune system, including inflammation. And so then you get the opening, the permeability of the blood-brain barrier, which is, I mean, it's there for a reason, right? To protect the brain. You know, when the door is wide open, things come in that you don't want to come in there. So that's the mechanism. Now, how does it show up? Well, I already talked about the basic signs and symptoms, so pain, chronic headaches, frequent headaches. How often do people come in complaining of pain and headaches? Like, that's a fairly frequent thing. And how often are headaches associated with any toxicant overload? Pretty common, right? Those of you who were here yesterday and I showed the different pictures of the different toxicants, headaches was on there a lot, right? Especially in the heavy metals. Cognitive decline. Mood disorders, and then all the problems of traumatic brain injury that go on. Could you put me down for a salmon? There, thank you. Now, the diseases that are associated that are now clearly neuroinflammation is a part of these diseases, which those of you who've been out of school for a while, maybe those of you who are still in school, don't even have this information. ADHD is known neuroinflammation. Alzheimer's, known neuroinflammation. It's not just the neurofibrillary tangles and beta amyloid plaque anymore. It's neuroinflammation is a hallmark, now known as a hallmark in Alzheimer's. ALS, Lou Gehrig's disease, a hallmark, neuroinflammation. Autism, hallmark, neuroinflammation. bipolar disorder, hallmark neuroinflammation, multiple sclerosis, and all the motor neuron diseases. Parkinsonism, known hallmark now neuroinflammation. Seizures and strokes, the sequelae after strokes, known neuroinflammation. All those things. Now, Parkinson's has been clearly an environmental issue, an environmentally induced issue for quite a while now. Alzheimer's is really turning out to be that way as well. So these are known. It's not just like, yeah, we find it as well. These are now known as hallmark presence of neuroinflammation in all these diseases, not just, oh yeah, we kind of find it there also. So, you know, pain, what's the classic treatment for pain? Isn't anti-inflammatories a classic pain treatment, right? But when it gets this chronic situation, how to deal with the chronic inflammation that's going on? You know that you got people with chronic pain, they take an anti-inflammatory, and by the time it's out of the bloodstream, their pain's back, right? It's a chronic inflammatory buildup. You know that happens in other parts of the body that have a lot more circulatory presence, blood flow, that's able to move things up because it's a systemic process of cytokines. We have to change the systemic cytokine picture. How do you do that? We're going to show you. And it's not just one way. It's a bunch of ways. You're going to love it. You're just going to love it. So let's talk about cognition for a while, okay? So what caused a drop in cognition and executive function in the brain? The known toxicants, vehicular exhaust, the stuff we're breathing every day, phthalates, the plasticizers, organophosphate pesticides, heavy metals, and PCBs, clearly associated. Now, the trouble is, oh my goodness, guess what? The IQ's been going down. It's been going down. We are now, I think, 14 points IQ average lower than they were in Victorian England. 14 points. Now, IQ points are, you know, each point is significant. 14 points is like, oh my. I thought, but we've invented all this great stuff. Aren't we smarter now? No, we're actually not. And the predictions, here's the predictions for world IQ over time is, oh my goodness. This is just since 1950. This is just the drop since 1950. This doesn't even show the data from Victorian England. So, IQ is going down.
My name is Dr. Stephen Ducat. I'm both a naturopathic doctor and a clinical psychologist. I specialize in naturopathic psychiatry. A tip that may be of interest is some recent experiences that I've had working with a couple of depressed men. It turns out both of them had elevated estrogen and elevated BPA. BPA and elevated estrogen, both of these elevations can independently produce mood disorders. But I think there's a relationship between the two. As I did some research on these particular cases, learned that BPA does elevate aromatase, which in these patients especially enable the conversion of testosterone to estrogen. Their testosterone, by the way, their testosterone levels were completely normal. And because I dug in a little deeper and looked at the estrogen, I was able to see that was really elevated, which would lead me to look at aromatase, which led me to look at BPA as the most BPA exposure as the most upstream factor here. And so that's my one-minute tip.
So what role do environmental toxins play in the initiation of autoimmune disease? We saw Dr. Aristo Vogiani at the conference, and we sat down for a few minutes to ask him exactly that. So Dr. Vogiani, why do we have such a massive increase in the number of autoimmune diseases in America?
According to Autoimmune Disease Association, 53 million Americans are suffering from autoimmune diseases. And according to National Institutes of Health, genes are responsible for 1/3 of autoimmune diseases. The triggers are responsible for the other 2/3 of autoimmune diseases. So the environmental factors are playing a significant role in the induction of autoimmune diseases. Obviously, we are doing something today that we didn't do 50 years ago that could be a reason why autoimmune diseases are on the rise.
So what are some of the common environmental triggers that you see causing autoimmune disease?
Toxic chemicals in the environment, such as formaldehyde, isocyanate, bisphenol A from the plastic, food additives, food colorings, nanoparticles. In fact, an article published in the Journal of Autoimmune Reviews showed that due to addition of some of these factors into the food, there is direct correlation between the amount of some of these new material we are consuming today that we did not consume 20 years ago, 50 years ago, there is direct correlation between autoimmunity and the usage of these toxic chemicals. So the more toxic chemicals are introduced into our environment, the more toxic chemicals get into our body. So there is a notion out there, unfortunately, that we think, and many scientists think, that chemicals are in and out. That may be correct in 80% of the cases. Yeah. But in other 20%, it is enough, the 20% of the chemicals not to get out from our body, but bind to our tissue and set the stage for development of autoimmune diseases. That's the mechanism of autoimmune disease. So chemicals are not in and out. It is enough small amount of chemicals to bind to our tissue and induce autoimmunity, which more than 100 of those autoimmune diseases are well recognized these days.
Doctor, it seems like in the last couple of years, there's been more of a focus on the fact that some of these autoimmune diseases are reversible. What are your thoughts on reversing autoimmune disease?
Find the triggers. The trigger could be chemical in one person, infection in another person, could be gum infection, could be bacteria in the gut, or certain foods such as gluten, dairy, other foods. By identifying them, and then by removing the triggers from the environment of the patient, these kind of clinicians will be successful in some cases to reverse the course of autoimmune disease. So the message is here that the earlier autoimmune reactivities versus autoimmune disease, reactivity is when the patient is making antibody but doesn't have loss of functionality. When the patient is losing functionality, maybe it's too late. We can only stop it. But if we can detect at the early stage autoimmune diseases, that's my job, that develop biomarkers for that. Yeah. Then we can identify the triggers, remove the triggers, and prevent progression of autoimmune reactivity to full-blown autoimmune disease. So there is window of opportunity of probably 5 years to 10 years. You detect antibody first, identify the triggers, remove the triggers, and then that patient is not going to progress to full-blown autoimmune disease. So the bottom line is detect, remove, and repair. That's my really final message for prevention of autoimmune diseases.
Thanks so much for watching The Evolution of Environmental Medicine. We have some really exciting new sponsors on the show. Dry Farm Wines is the first subscription service that only serves biodynamic and organic wines, and even low-carb wines that are suitable for diabetics. They have a subscription program, and one exciting thing I'm here to announce is that for all the Functional Forum meetup groups. If you have more than 20 practitioners in your meetup group and you get 20 people and you're watching it here today, you can apply to have free wine sent to your meetup group for the May Functional Forum. So check out www.goevomed.com/DFW to find out more about dry farm wines. This episode is also brought to you by the Evolution of Medicine and our Thought 3 core programs. You're going to be hearing a little bit from Dr. Marisol Tejero, and she's going to be talking about community structures for delivering group detoxes and a community on a cleanse. Our program, the New Patient GPS, is a training program to help you find new patients in your community through a combination of Facebook ads and Eventbrite to bring in consistent new people into your practice. And then our practice accelerator at goevomed.com/accelerator is the ultimate training in how to build a scalable, efficient, functional, integrative, or naturopathic practice. Check out the links below. Thanks so much for watching. Enjoy. So a warm welcome to the show, Dr. Marisol.
Thank you.
You know, one of the big themes in the Functional Forum is community. And when I heard about your community on a cleanse, it got me really excited because we're looking at ways to bring this kind of environmental medicine to the masses. So can you tell us a little bit about community on a cleanse?
Sure. My whole idea about starting the community on a cleanse was to actually get my patients re-engaging on a yearly basis on doing a cleanse. And what I found was that they would do a cleanse with me in clinic. However, they would fall off over time and not repeat the cleanse. So it began as a way to keep my patients engaged in the process of cleansing on a regular basis.
And so you've been doing this for a number of years now. Can you tell us sort of what your community cleanse looked like last year?
Sure. So last year we had it in a wonderful location. It's a major auditorium where we have headlining speakers coming to my town up in Canada in Kitchener-Waterloo. And the capacity of the auditorium is about 200 people. We have in the hallway vendors from all the different local organizations who are either health promoting in some way, shape, or form. So they're either a practitioner or perhaps they have a health food store or they offer local organic meats. Basically, all the locations and places where we can get our tools to be doing a cleanse. Our cleanse is based on a 10-day diet plan, as well as us having that one night where people come, they shop, they purchase from the suppliers, and then they hear us speak for about an hour, and we tell them all the reasons why it's important to cleanse. Our audience is both a mixture of our patients, about 20% are patients, 20 to 30%, and then the other percentage is all new people who've either met us from our flyers or have heard us speak somewhere else or who are now on our mailing list.
Okay, great. Yeah. And so you do the one live event and then they have resources to take away. How much do you charge for to come to the event?
So the cost to come to the event is $35 ahead of time and at the door $50. So it's a pretty good deal for people to come. They get the 10-day cleanse, so an entire meal plan. They also get daily emails letting them know repetition about the principles of cleansing. So we'll tell them, you know, water. We'll talk about water. We'll talk about why organic foods. We'll talk about why we don't want people to have coffee or alcohol during a cleanse. So we speak about all these different things.
And so, you know, as a practice building strategy, it seems like it's a good low-cost way to bring in people who at a low level, and then they can come in for more high touch services into the practice.
Absolutely. I think the important part about being in the alternative and complementary, however you want to call that, is that it's tough. You need to get FaceTime with potential patients. Once you get FaceTime and they get a real sense for your energy, they'll absolutely want to engage in your clinical practice. And for many people who've participated in our cleanse, they'll have benefits right off the bat. So many of the principles we teach are no different than what we would teach our patients. Things like drink green tea every day, right? Or, you know, fast within the morning. So we start implementing the practices that we want them to have when they start with our practice.
Absolutely. Have you found any ways to sort of engage any peer-to-peer connections between those groups of people that want to get healthy?
Sure. So we have done things on Facebook in terms of, you know, tell us your experience. So because people have benefit like losing weight or feeling better, more energy after the cleanse, losing their bloat, we'll have them actually do a competition. So let us know your story. And we post it on Facebook to kind of see how people are doing and a little bit of a challenge for people.
So like a private group?
Yeah.
All in?
Actually, no, just on our main Facebook page.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, and then we will select which ones we like the best. We do top one, top two, top three, and then we give them a prize. And those people typically will get a prize to come into our clinic, which is like a week cleanse or perhaps a colon hydrotherapy or a basket of teas, something like that.
That's great.
Yeah.
Well, it seems like, you know, I know in Canada it's tricky because you're going up against a free healthcare system.
Yes.
So it seems that, you know, this is an innovation that can be repeated in Canada, but also all the way, you know, in the United States more easily.
Absolutely. I've made my name as the cleanse curator in my area in Kitchener-Waterloo. So people are seeking me out for cleansing in specific. And it is definitely a different market because everyone, their health is paid for. So for people wanting to improve their health and optimize and not just take care of their sickness, they need to seek out someone like us. So I find that the want entryway or gateway events to kind of have people introduced into what is natural medicine is a great way to build a practice.
Absolutely. Yeah. You know, there's so many great ways, so many great things you're talking about there, about creating a live environment to interact, creating a low-cost offer to interact with the clinic and interact with you, and as you said, get a feeling for who you are and your energy. You know, one of the other things that I heard when we were speaking before is that your practice has slowly grown. Now, if someone came to your practice today, they probably see something substantial that they thought, well, I could never do that, but it sounds like, just like most doctors, there was a micro-practice moment at the beginning of your career, right?
Absolutely. So I've been in practice for 5 years now, and it went step by step by step. Initially, I rented a small room, which was perhaps 400 square feet at the most. All my supplements, all my products were all carried under my table for treatment. And then within about a year, in 3 months, I was fully booked. I had started only with 2 days. In 3 months, I was fully booked. And that was a lot of work, you know, pounding the pavement, getting out there, doing that FaceTime. And then I purchased a property, so a 1,400 square feet. And I made that into my cleanse center that I presently have. And that, we moved in there about 3 years ago, and we were busting out of the seams about a year ago.
Okay.
So I have now another property which I purchased, which I'll be evolving to a 4,000 square foot location. And it's been step-by-step transition, and it has been a lot of hard work. I don't claim that it hasn't been.
Yeah.
I wasn't gifted this practice, but I started small with low overhead. My overhead has grown exponentially over time, as have my employees, but I'm now in a team. I have two other naturopathic doctors. I have, you know, 4 to 5 staff here and there, right? So it really has grown.
What do you think about the positioning of environmental medicine and detox as a sort of a positioning for a functional naturopathic practice?
I think it's an excellent positioning because for me, A, it's my passion, and B, it's what I love to do, and C, people are really wanting that because it's something that's already in the media.
Yeah.
You know, you'll see Hollywood starlets doing a cleanse or a juice fast or what have you, right? Like Gwyneth Paltrow is doing her newest thing. So people are already attracted to it and they don't really know what it is about. So they want to try it. And there's a huge association with cleansing and weight loss. And weight loss is still a driver for bringing people into our practices, right?
Is there a time of year where you found that you run those events because there's an excitement or you can get more people in?
Yeah, so my patients are very well educated. One of my goals and practices is to make sure that I make my patients self-sufficient.
Yeah.
I of course want them coming in to see me and to visit me, but I want them to know when they need to do that and what they need to book on their own in my practice. So for their cleanse as an example. So we actually time 2 yearly events, the Community on a Cleanse in the spring and the fall Slim Fast in the fall. And we do that as a way to encourage, because one of our messages is that people should be cleansing at least twice a year. So we want them to come in and pre-book all their cleanses and have the kickoff be that Community on a Cleanse or the Fall Slim Fast.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
It's really amazing to come to these conferences. You know, we're always looking for not only how this can be delivered one-on-one, you know, we've had a lot of clinical information about what to look for, signs and symptoms, diagnosis, treatment, but also how this can reach the masses. And so I would say, you know, thank you for taking the initiative to make these systems. And I hope that if you're watching and listening today, you've got some ideas about how you could fill your practice with educated people who are ready to take it on to the next level. And also, I like the idea of using a third party space. You know, you don't have to have a space with 200 people that you're only going to fill twice a year.
No.
Use a space that already exists in your community.
Yeah, and the key to it, you said it in your final words, education. My primary goal in practice is to have highly educated patients. Patients who know why they're doing it, why they are paying the out-of-pocket to do this, and for them to know what to do. So every visit, every encounter I have with a patient is all about how I can educate them so that they know what to do in the future. And that's, I think, feel is the true goal. And in environmental medicine, and as a cleanse curator, I want people to know all the tips and tools of cleansing and how to keep their lifestyle healthy.
Beautiful. Yeah. And it's interesting you said about the different vendors, because I can see that, you know, that once you educate a patient that they need to choose different personal care products, choose different food choices, meat choices, otherwise, it opens up a whole new shopping experience that you can also curate.
Absolutely. And that key is that not only are they with other vendors, but they're also constantly getting the same message, which is important, right? How many times does it take a person to actually ingrain a message? It's 7 to 9 times, same as like your logo or your branding. So if they're going to all the other vendors who know about you and are working with you, that message is reinforced.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Integrative medicine, naturopathic medicine, entrepreneurship is alive and well in Canada. Dr. Marisol, thanks so much for providing such a great example to our community. I hope this has been useful, and we'll see you soon.
Thank you.
Thanks so much for tuning in to this special episode of the Functional Forum. We've been at the Environmental Health Symposium in California. You know, my challenge to you as someone watching this conference is this: how can we make this type of care available to everyone in the community? How can we increase access to environmental medicine? The environment's only going to get worse, and so the desire and the need is for our community to be able to build a system that is capable of really working with everyone. And that's going to take practitioners and physicians coming together, communities coming together to work out how to deliver this kind of care. We've given you some ideas today. We'd love to hear your ideas. Thanks so much for being part of our community, and we can solve this together. Our next episode, we are coming to you on May 1st, live from Minneapolis, Minnesota. It's the evolution of primary care. We'll see you there.